Welcome back. New data revealing 30 GTA neighbourhoods with some troublingly high COVID-19 positivity rates. What's behind all of this? How is all this information gathered? Joining me now, Dr. Laura Rosella, a scientist with Toronto-based ICES, a nonprofit health research institute that has been working on data connected to the pandemic. And we're going to take a look at some of these hardest hit areas. Good morning to you, Dr. Rosella.
Good morning.
I want to get through some of the data first, and a troubling number that definitely caught my attention was in one specific neighborhood in Brampton, and it's very targeted. So an area north of Queen East, east of Airport Road, 19% positivity rate. That's a rate double that of the U.S. I mean, when you put some things into perspective, and that is so very troubling. So let's backtrack a little bit in how you're able to pinpoint this data.
Right. So of all the tests that are being done in the province, they get put into a centralized system. And the team at ICES has been looking at these numbers for a very long time, trying to understand how many of those tests that are being done are coming back positive. And that's been an analysis that's been done throughout the pandemic. More recently, looking at where the percent positivity varies and how much it varies. And that's what this recent analysis is showing, that first of all, it's very high. It's very high in Ontario and it's very high in certain regions. And further to that, it's concentrated specifically in certain areas, which is very concerning.
And is there anything common to all of these specific areas?
You know, I think that's a really good point to emphasize, that the reasons for the high percent positivity can actually vary quite a bit between different regions. We know that the ability to physically distance is key. And so when people are in certain jobs, essential workers, where it makes physically distancing very hard and their risk is higher, that's a key commonality. Perhaps living in bigger households with lots of individuals crowding. The challenge there is that if someone gets infected at work, comes home, much more likely that many people in that household are infected, and that accelerates spread.
How does testing come into play in here, and does that need to be ramped up, perhaps localized?
Well, I would say one of the good news stories is that the testing levels have increased quite a bit. And so there was a period of time, many people will recall long lineups, et cetera, around Thanksgiving. And from that point, the testing numbers have increased significantly. So a lot of testing is being done. That's not the reason why the percent positivity is so high. Of course, more testing would help, especially in certain areas. But the percent positivity is so high because the community transmission and the numbers are very high in those regions.
Mm-hmm. We've done some stories here with City News and Breakfast Television looking at perhaps communication failing and as perhaps another added layer to why some of these rates may be high, with perhaps as not enough information specifically to these communities being given out. Do you think that would help?
Definitely clear communication would help. And again, this goes across the board, not just in certain regions. I think people are tired, maybe confused by some of the messaging. But again, when you see numbers this high, there's many things going wrong. It's not just people aren't getting the message or the message isn't clear. Definitely clear messaging would help, especially around, you know, physically distancing and supports to help people do that. Mm-hmm. I truly believe nobody wants to infect their family. Nobody wants high community rates in their region. There's some supports that are needed to help them do that. Communication might be one strategy to specific subgroups that may need additional help, especially when it's not obvious how they can physically distance, for example. Do they need additional supports? Do they need, you know, there's quarantine hotels that have popped up in other regions. I think those are the factors that are more likely going to have a big difference.
I was going to ask you, do we need more of these sort of isolation centers where people cannot separate, right? You can't physically distance. And as you mentioned, no one wants to infect their immediate family member. But if you don't have a space to go to where you really have no choice, it puts you out of options. So what do you do with all of this data? Do you present this to various municipalities? What is the next step?
Yeah, so the first and foremost, it's making the data available to as many people as possible. This includes decision makers who are trying to decide on policies, to communities, and to help conversations, for example, Peel Public Health Unit's been doing a great job trying to connect with community leaders and trying to understand how they can move forward. We see that, also happening in Toronto Public Health. So it's basically making sure the data is available to as many people as possible. And one of the messages has been, well, when the data is localized, it's available at the community level, it really facilitates some further conversation. We know transmission's high. Mm-hmm. What can we do about it? And understanding areas where it's highest really facilitates that conversation.
Absolutely. All right, Dr. Rosella, some really great information here. Thank you so much for the work that you're doing.
Thank you for having me.